بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَكُمْ لَا تَسْفِكُونَ دِمَاءَكُمْ وَلَا تُخْرِجُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ ثُمَّ أَقْرَرْتُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَشْهَدُونَ. ثُمَّ أَنْتُمْ هَؤُلَاءِ تَقْتُلُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَتُخْرِجُونَ فَرِيقًا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ تَظَاهَرُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِالْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ وَإِنْ يَأْتُوكُمْ أُسَارَى تُفَادُوهُمْ وَهُوَ مُحَرَّمٌ عَلَيْكُمْ إِخْرَاجُهُمْ أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضٍ فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَى أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُا الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا بِالْآخِرَةِ فَلَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابُ وَلَا هُمْ يُنْصَرُونَ. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَقَفَّيْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ بِالرُّسُلِ وَآتَيْنَا عِيسَى ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَيَّدْنَاهُ بِرُوحِ الْقُدُسِ. أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ بِمَا لَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُكُمْ اسْتَكْبَرْتُمْ فَفَرِيقًا كَذَّبْتُمْ وَفَرِيقًا تَقْتُلُونَ. صدق الله العظيم. Today we are starting from Ayah 83, inshaAllah. In the previous ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about Yahud, Bani Israel. And once again, I need to remind that when we say Yahud or Bani Israel in the terminology of Al-Quran Al-Kareem, it does not really mean a curse word. It doesn't mean a bad word that we are saying that they are Yahud. In fact, it is talking about the believers of that time. Yahud were the believers of the time of Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. Of course, when Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wassalam came and they rejected Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, that was the start of the kufr, where those who rejected Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, they were disbelievers as they disbelieved in Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came and they rejected Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they were considered disbelievers because they rejected the Prophet of Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But at the time of Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam, they were the believers of that time. So every incident that talks about Yahud at the time of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam, and after Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, throughout the period of Bani Israel, we could say before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, generally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the believers of that time, and giving us the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam a lesson from their behavior, from their examples, that see the believers of that time made these mistakes. Make sure, O believers of this time, you don't repeat the same mistake. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us of a very similar thing in ayah 83, وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, remember when we took a pledge from Bani Israel, children of Israel means children of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. What pledge did we take from them? 8 things that Allah have mentioned in this ayah. لا تعبدون إلا الله, that you would not worship anyone other than Allah. وبالوالدين إحسانا, and be kind to your parents. وذي القربى, and relatives. واليتامى, and orphans. والمساكين, and the needy. وقولوا للناس حسنا, and say a good word to people. ثم توليتم وأقيموا الصلاة, and establish صلاة, وآتوا الزكاة, and pay the زكاة. ثم توليتم إلا قليلا منكم وأنتم معرضون. Then most of you turned away from these orders. وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ, and you are still turning away from it. Let's look at the 8 orders. Number 1, لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, you would not worship anyone besides Allah. Number 2, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, kindness towards the parents. Number 3, وَذِي الْقُرْبَى, kindness towards relatives. Number 4, يَتَامَى, kindness towards orphans. Number 5, masakin, kindness towards the needy and the poor. Number 6, qulu lin-nasi husna, say a good word to people. When you talk to people with in a good way. Wa aqimu as-salah, number 7, aqimu as-salah, number 8, wa atu az-zakah. These are the 8 orders that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given to Bani Israel, and was not just an order, it was a pledge that was taken from them through their Anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he says about these orders, ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ, you made this pledge, you accepted these orders, and you pledged to follow them all the time in your future, but you turned away from these orders. وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ, it could mean that you is not that you did not follow it because out of ignorance or because you forgot. The reason you people did not follow it is because وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ, you were turning away from Allah's orders. That was the reason. So this could be the reason. Number 2, the second meaning of وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ could be the one that I used in the translation, and that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the people who were there at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That this was the pledge taken from Bani Israel. So they could say that, okay, those people made a pledge and they did not fulfill it. Why are you telling me? Why are you blaming me for it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them, وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ, you are still turning away from it. You still are not following those orders. And this one seems to be the stronger point, as this will answer a lot of questions that would come in different ayahs, that why Allah is talking to those people at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about what their forefathers did. When Allah says to them, you killed the prophets, these people did not kill those prophets. It was their forefathers. It was someone 1,000 years back, 600 years back, 500 years back, who killed those prophets. Why are you telling me that we did it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because you still agree with it. You are still on the same page. You don't deny it. You don't dislike it. You don't say that you have nothing to do with it. In fact, you agree with all of what was done by your elders. So that simply means you are part of it. If you agree with it, you are part of it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. The first order or the first pledge that was taken from Bani Israel is لا تعبدون إلا الله. that do not worship anyone beside Allah. Of course, this is the most important order of every Sharia. Every Prophet of Allah that came to the world, that was the beginning point of his message, لا تعبدون إلا الله. Do not worship anyone beside Allah. Oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawheed, oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the most important part of the Sharia. Without Tawheed, without the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is nothing that would be accepted if a person does everything else, believes in everything else, but wal'ayazu billah, associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With shirk, nothing could be accepted. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very, very clear in Quran al-Kareem, that إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah will not forgive shirk. Other than shirk, He would forgive anything. So shirk can never be accepted and can never be forgiven. Therefore, the beginning point of every prophet's message is لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. There is no God but Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Anbiya, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. Every prophet that we sent before you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we sent this message to that prophet, أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا, that there is no God but me, so do not associate any partners with me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, we sent this wahi to every prophet. This was a common message given to every prophet of Allah. In Surah An-Nahl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ. We sent a messenger to every nation telling them, أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاشْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ, that you should worship Allah and refrain from associating any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So oneness of Allah is the main message of every deen, of every prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after that, after tawheed, after the oneness of Allah, then everything comes in place. Oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mean that we just say that there is no God, but when it comes to practical life, we depend on others, we start giving the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to other things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Razzaq. So that simply means we should not consider anyone else to be Razzaq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Khaliq. We should not consider anyone else to be Khaliq. Allah is Rabb. So no one else should be considered Rabb. With all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with everything that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is my quality. It's for me. I am the one who would do this. I am the one who controls this. Qudra, sam'a, basar, everything that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we do not associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his ibadah and in any of his attributes. The second order Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us in this ayah is wabil walidayn ihsana, kindness towards parents. If we want to explain to someone why Allah is the one that is supposed to be worshipped, the easiest way to explain is that Allah is Khaliq. Who created you? Allah. If Allah created everything, He's our creator. Whatever we have is through His creation. It's because He created. He created us. He created all of our ni'mas that we have, all the blessings that we have, He created them. So everything that we have, He created. And whatever we have in our life is through the creation of Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. So through His quality of khalq. So Allah is Khaliq. Therefore, we should not be worshipping anyone beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if you look how Allah created us, the means of coming into this world for us is our parents. He sent us to this world through our parents. So Allah is the creator, but He created us, He brought us into this world through our parents. And therefore, right after لا تعبدون إلا الله is وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this point even more strongly in Surah Bani Israel, where he says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah says that I have ordered, I have been, qada is really to make a decision. When a judge makes a final decision, we said qada al-qadi. This judge have made the final decision. Allah says, I have made this final decision. Allah ta'budu illa iya. This is my final order that can never be changed. And this is something that I have ordered everyone. Allah ta'budu illa iya. That do not worship anyone beside Allah. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And be kind to your parents. So kindness to parents comes next to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I said, it's very easy to understand it, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, and He, the means of creation, the one, the means that He used for sending us to this world is our parents. Therefore, He ordered us, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, kindness towards parents. Unfortunately, this is the order of Sharia. If we look at it in our societies, in our communities nowadays, we see it neglected so badly that in many situations, people don't even consider this of any importance anymore. Oh yeah, I have to be nice. But, you know, my parents do this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this point so clear in Quran when He tells us, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Do not even say uff to your parents. And what does saying uff means? Uff does not mean that you tell them, I'm not going to do it. I won't do it. This is not uff. This is much beyond uff. Now you're rejecting their order. Uff means you do it, but you make some type of noise or some action by which they would feel that you don't feel like doing it. Son, get me a glass of water. Oh, and the person gets up, he brings the glass of water, hands it to his father. This is uff. You did it. But that sound that you made, that made him feel that you're tired and you don't feel like doing it. Now, if he wants another glass of water, do you think he would feel free to say it as we made that sound in the first place? He would feel that, you know, my son is tired, I shouldn't tell him now. Allah says, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Don't even say uff to them. So what's the hukum of just saying uff, which means you fulfill the order, but you do something by which you make them feel that you are tired or you don't feel like doing it or you don't want to do it. Just that giving them that feeling falls under uff, which is haram according to the ayah of Quran. So imagine when children are going beyond this uff. And they will say it straightforward, I won't do it. I can't do this. Why do you always pick on me? Why don't you tell your my brothers? Why don't you tell the other ones? And unfortunately, sometime now, worse than that, children will say to parents, why don't you do it? Yes. And it goes beyond this. If I tell you the words that we hear from children towards their parents, it's amazing. You know, you can't even believe that you are living at a time when things like this are happening. Children curse at their parents on their face. They would just curse at them. Children will shout at their parents. Subhanallah. Imagine the type of sin that is. In many cases, parents are equally considered to be sinners. I don't want to use the word criminals in this action. As the children are getting the sin, really many times parents are playing a big role in making their children do these things. It's not because they're asking them for too much. It's because they never provided them with that education that will tell them that this is haram for you to do. We put them at places where this is what they learn, disobedience. They're encouraged to disobey their parents. They're encouraged to shout at their parents. They're encouraged to argue with their parents. And they are told, your parents are nothing. They are just to provide you with the proper accommodation and make sure that your needs are being fulfilled. Other than that, your parents can't tell you anything. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Quran, our parents are everything for us. They have a full right over us. A man complained to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that, Ya Rasulullah, my father takes away all of my wealth. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called the father and asked him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I spend it on him and all of his needs and whatever the other things. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the son, Anta wa maluka liya bi. You and your wealth belong to your father. You and your wealth belong to your father. Can anyone do it in today's day? Anta wa maluka liya bi. He takes $100, we will complain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what Allah is teaching us. This is what hadith are teaching us. This is what our deen is teaching us. But our children have no clue of it. They don't know it. They don't understand it. They have never seen it. They haven't seen it from their parents towards their parents. So of course then this continues. In some of the histories, the story has been narrated that a son got upset with his father and he started beating up his father and he dragged his father out of the house. He pulled him out. He dragged him out of the house to a point where there was a tree. He took him all the way to the tree. When he took him to that tree, the father says to his son, son, stop it here. That's it. Don't go beyond this. So the son was so amazed that, why my dad didn't say anything up to this point and now he's saying don't go beyond this point. So the son stopped and he asked his dad, why did you tell me to stop here? He said, son, because I remember I did the same thing to my dad. I pulled him to this tree. And this is something that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the hadith, that the way we treat our elders, this is how we would be treated once we get to that age. We would be treated the way we treat our elders. So, wa bil walidayni ihsana, kindness towards parents. Wa dhil qurba, and to the relatives. Again, of course, if this was our behavior to our parents, imagine what would be our behavior to our relatives, uncles, our aunts, our cousins. They really mean nothing anymore. Grandparents. These relationships mean nothing anymore. We don't even consider it of any importance in our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it in Quran with so much importance, wadhil qurba, kindness towards your relatives. In fact, most of the families, you would realize, you would see that they have problems with their relatives. They don't get along. Oh, I don't like that uncle. I don't like my aunt. I don't visit them anymore. I don't want to see them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered us with silatul rahim, joining the relationship. And what does joining the relationship means? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself explained in the hadith. When he said, لَيْسَ الْوَاصِلُ بِالْمُكَافِئِ وَلَكِنَّ الْوَاصِلُ الَّذِي إِذَا قُطِعَتْ رَحِمُهُ وَصَلَهَا. The person who is being, who's kind to his relatives, who are kind to him, he is not the one who's joining the relationship. The one who's joining the relationship, and all the reward mentioned in the hadith for joining the relationship, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, is for those who have relatives, they are breaking the relationship with him and he's joining them. Because if they are kind to you, it's already there. You are not joining anything. It's already there and you are keeping it. But when they are breaking it, then you are joining it. The order in the ahadith is to join the relationship, which means even if we have our relatives who are breaking it and the tree that's not in a good way, they hurt us, they talk against us, they do whatever. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that our responsibility is to join the relationship with them. Call them occasionally. I just called to say salam. I just called to see how you are doing. Send them a gift. That this was a small gift just because I remembered you. These things are part of joining the relationship. You can't spend too much time with them, that's fine. But at least the relationship has to be there. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, on the day of judgment, silatul rahim, joining the relationship, will be holding to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This quality of silatul rahim will be joining, will be holding to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will say, Ya Allah, man wasalani من وصلني فأوصله. Ya Allah, whoever have joined me, you join his connection also with you, Ya Allah. And whoever broke me in this world, in that world, Ya Allah, you break his connection with him too. It's a very important silat al-rahim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَذِي الْقُرْبَى, joining the relationships. وَلْيَتَامَى, being kind to our relatives. And وَلْيَتَامَى, being kind to the orphans. Orphans, according to the Sharia, orphan is the person, is a child who have lost his father or her father before the age of puberty. That's an orphan. If we look at our society, we will see that generally orphans are so badly neglected that no one even cares, no one even think about orphans. Orphans within our own families, and we don't even think about them. We would waste so much of our wealth here and there. And we have so many orphans. Maybe we have them within our own family, but we don't care about them. They are part of our dhil qurba and they are yatama. And they may be masakeen, subhanAllah, so many things that are telling us that we should be nice to these people. And by taking care of that person, you're getting so much reward of joining the relationship and of taking care of a poor and a needy person and of taking care of an orphan when they are from within the family. But even if they are not from within the family, still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us, وَلِيَتَامَى, take care of the orphans. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specially ordered Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we see it in Surah Al-Duha, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. That when you have an orphan, make sure never reject the orphan. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presents this as a question to all of us. Have you ever seen a person who does not believe on the day of judgment? Ad-deen is judgment. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, the owner of the day of judgment. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Have you seen a person who does not believe in hereafter, who does not believe in judgment? And of course, right away we will think about the kuffar that we may have met sometime in our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't look outside, look within yourself. فَذَٰلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. That is a person who rejects the orphans. Allah says, if you want to see a person who does not believe, who does not believe on the day of judgment, فَذَٰلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. That is the person who rejects the orphan. وَلَا يَحُضُّ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. And does not encourage others to feed the poor and needy. It's not that he doesn't care, take care of the orphans, of the needy. He doesn't even encourage others. If you can't do it, at least tell someone who could do it. You know some needy people. You can't help them. Tell someone. Go and inform others. Do something to help these people, even if you don't have anything to help them. That's our responsibility. فذلك الذي يدع اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين. That is the person who rejects the orphans ولا يحض على طعام المسكين and does not encourage others to feed the poor. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his childhood, he was an orphan. And we know the whole clan of Bani Sa'd went to Makkah Mukarramah, and almost every woman from that clan knocked at the door of Amina, knowing that she just had a child. And when they find, once they will find out that this child is an orphan, they would reject the orphan. No, we don't want this orphan. If he's an orphan, we can't take him. Subhanallah, if only they knew that this orphan has all the khair and barakah of the dunya, not only of that time. And how lucky was Halima Sa'diya, who finally got Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she decided to take this orphan. It comes with khair and barakah. Of course, that was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but they always come with khair and barakah. There is always khair and barakah in taking care of the needy people, of the orphans. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, إِنَّمَا تُرْزَقُونَ وَتُنصَرُونَ بِضُعَفَائِكُمْ. Allah provides you with rizq and He helps you because of the needy ones that you are taking care of. They could be our children, they could be our parents, they could be other orphans and needy families around us. إِنَّمَا تُنصَرُونَ وَتُرْزَقُونَ بِضُعَفَائِكُمْ. Allah opens the doors of rizq for this person because he is taking care of the needy people. And as I said, needy people doesn't necessarily refers to orphans and people that are not related to him. It could be our own children. When they are du'afa, when they are weak and we are taking care of them, this is part of our deen. This is part of our iman. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, narrated by Imam Ahmad rahimahullah in his Musnad, on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Umama al-Bahili radiyallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man masaha ra'sa yateem," a person who would put his hand on the head of an orphan, "lam yamsahhu illa lillah," and he does it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "kana lahu bikulli sha'ratin marrat 'alayha yaduhu hasanat," he will get reward for every hair that's on the head of this child. And it's not only one reward, hasanat. He will get many rewards for every hair that he have touched on the head of this child. This is not to tell us that we need to count now the hair, and if he's bald, you are not getting any reward. It simply means Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us the tremendous reward that is there for being kind to orphans. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَنْ أَحْسَلَ إِلَىٰ يَتِيمٍ أَوْ يَتِيمَةٍ عِنْدَهُ كُنْتُ أَنَا وَهُوَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَهَاتَيْنِ. A person who's kind to an orphan that he's taking care of, me and that person in Jannah will be together like this. And he put both of his fingers together. The index finger and the middle finger, he put them together. He said, this is how we will be together in Jannah. The person who takes care of an orphan. In another hadith, rated again by Imam Ahmad rahimahullah in his Musnad, on the authority of Sayyidina Amr bin Malik radiyallahu anhu, who says, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, من أدرك أحد والديه ثم لم يغفر له فأبعده الله. A person who gets one of his parents in their old age, and that person does not get the Jannah through serving his father or his mother, whoever is alive out of the two parents, then Allah will not open any other door for this person. A person who has one of his parents alive in their old age and does not get the Jannah by serving his parents, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَأَبْعَدُهُ اللَّهُ, Allah will keep him away from all the rahmah. He have closed all the doors of rahmah on himself. Number two, وَمَنْ ضَمَّ يَتِيمًا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَبَوَيْنِ مُسْلِمَيْنِ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ وَشَرَابِهِ حتى يغنيه الله وجبت له الجنة. A person who takes care of an orphan so much that that orphan eats and drinks with him, which means keeps the orphan with him until this person, this orphan is independent. One thing that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned here as a condition, min abawain muslimain, a Muslim orphan, an orphan that had Muslim parents. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wajabat lahul jannah. Jannah is wajib, is must for this person now. Imagine the reward of taking care of the orphans. You take care of one orphan. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, wajabat lahul jannah. Jannah is must for this person now. Nothing can keep him away from getting to Jannah. Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, have narrated in his Sahih, on the authority of Sahl ibn Sa'd radiyallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنَا وَكَافِلُ الْجَنَّةِ فِي وَكَافِلُ الْيَتِيمِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَهَاتَيْنِ. Me and the person who takes care of an orphan, now that condition is not there. مِنْ أَبَوَيْنِ مُسْلِمَيْنِ. That condition is not there. Any orphan. Could be Muslim, non-Muslim. فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَهَاتَيْنِ. We'll be together like this in Jannah. In another hadith, Imam Tabrani rahimahullah have narrated on the authority of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ أَحَبَّ الْبُيُوتِ إِلَى اللَّهِ بَيْتٌ فِيهِ يَتِيمٌ مُكَرَّمٌ. The dearest house to Allah on the earth is a house where there is an orphan who's been well taken care of. Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim rahimahullah have narrated on the authority of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-sa'i ala al-armalati wal-miskeen, kal-mujahidi fi sabilillah, wa kal-qa'imi la yaftur, wa kal-sa'imi la yuftir. Amazing hadith. The reward is something, if we really look at it from our understanding, we could say it's unbelievable. As I said, the hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person who takes care of a needy person or of a widow, he takes care of their needs. There is a widow and he just fulfills them. Maybe if she is in the neighborhood, for example, when he's going out for grocery, he buys the grocery for them, or he financially supports her, whatever. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a person who takes care of a widow or a needy person, that person, his reward is kal mujahidi fi sabilillah, like a person who is spending his life in doing jihad fi sabilillah. And his reward is like a person kal qa'im la yaftur, a person who performs tahajjud every night, does not get tired of doing salat at tahajjud. And wa kas-sa'im la yuftir, and his reward is just like a fasting person who never skips a fast. He's always fasting throughout his life. Amazing. Look at the reward. Mujahid and qa'im, tahajjud every day, every day, every night, and fasting every day. In another hadith, it has been narrated on the authority of Salama radiallahu anha, who once said to a sahabi, that I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, من أنفق على بنتين أو أختين أو ذواتي قرابة. A person who would financially support two daughters or two sisters or any two women out of his relatives. يحتسب النفقة عليهما. He spends on them just for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because many times we may spend on them and then we keep on reminding them, you know, I gave you that on that day, I gave you this much, and I helped you this, and I gave you this gift. No, this is only for the sake of Allah, only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَانَتَا لَهُ سِتْرًا مِّنَ النَّارِ. They would be a protection for this person against hellfire. Which means if he has a'mal, if he has sins that are leading him towards Jahannam, there would be a great protection for this person against Jahannam, that this person will not be thrown in Jahannam. Jahannam is haram on this person. If you look, and there are hundreds of ahadith. These are only few, very few out of those ahadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have mentioned, and they're all mentioned in Sahih and Sunan. I just mentioned these few examples so we can understand the great reward that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have mentioned for these qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mentioned in these ayahs. Allah la ta'buduna illallah wa bil walidayni ihsana, and kindness towards the parents, wa dhil qurba, and kindness to the relatives, wal yatama, and the orphans, wal masakin, and the needy people, wa qulu lin nasi husna. Then after this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa qulu lin nasi husna, and when you talk to people, say to people what is good. Husn is the same word that has been repeated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the first part of the order, ayah, He ordered us that our actions should be husn and ihsan. There should be ihsan in our action. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that in our words and use of the language, there should be husn and beauty too. So our actions and our words, both are good. Because sometimes, for some people, their actions are good, their words are not good. If they start talking to people, they become very abusive. They start cursing, they start shouting, they raise their voice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, actions and words, they both have to be good. One of the two is not enough. Ihsan in our actions and وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنَا. And when you talk to people, you must talk to people in a good way and tell them what is good. Looking at the word husn now, since husn is used for our actions and our words, we need to understand the word husn. What does husn mean? Husn means beauty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us to keep on beautifying our actions and keep on beautifying our words when we are dealing with people. And mainly, the most beautiful action and words should be towards our parents. What's the limit? As we say it in English, sky is the limit. Really, when it comes to husn, there is no limit. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanallah, this is the mu'jiza, this is the miracle of Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word, such a word, that you could say it's a miraculous word. There is no way of expressing this message in a better form than this, that you're telling the person that every time when you treat your parents, try to be better than you were before. Every time you treat these people, you should be better than before. So look at how you did last time and now bring more husn into it. Make it more beautiful. Generally, as our parents are getting towards old age, it just goes the other way around. When they are strong and young, there is a lot of husn, because you know what would happen. But when we see them getting into their old age, our husn goes away. Now, that treatment, the way we were treating them, the way we were talking to them, is not there anymore. Now we try to tell them, Dad, you don't know what you're talking about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, should be husn all the time. It should get better and better all the time. So our treatment to our parents, our relatives, to the needy, should always be getting better, not worse. Always remember, in these type of relationships, especially in these relationships, and then generally in every treatment, the point is, not how the other person is treating us, is what we are, how our behavior should be. I should treat this person according to who I am, not according to how he is. That person could be bad. A good example of that is that, you know, we have transformers, we have chargers that would charge our phones, for example, charge different machines. And you plug them into a plug that would produce 110 voltage. Or you can take it to another country where they use 220. And still you can plug the same charger. This charger will produce only 12 watts. This is how much your phone needs, and this is how much it will produce. It's not that if it is 110, you plug it in 110, it will produce 12, and if you plug it in 220, it will produce 24. If it would do that, it will burn your phone or whatever machine you're using with it. Same thing. If we start behaving with people according to how they are, we may burn our relationship with them. In order for us to keep that relationship, we should be like these chargers. That you produce only as much as that person needs and how much that person can take. Don't produce anything more than that. Regardless of how that person is behaving with you and how he treats you. He could be a needy person, some time would come, and he could be very abusive. The order to us is, you be kind to this person. If he's abusive, forgive him. This is additional reward for you. You are in fact getting another opportunity of earning even more reward now, a higher reward. It's like when Ali radiallahu anhu was fighting Amr ibn Wud. And that Amr ibn Wud was a person who was considered equivalent to 1,000 warriors. He was considered equivalent to 1,000 warriors. Extremely strong person from the days of Jahiliyyah amongst Quraysh. Ali radiallahu anhu wrestled him down and was about to cut his throat when Amr ibn Wud, he thought the last thing I could do at least so that I could do something to hurt him, he spit on Ali radiallahu anhu's face. As soon as he did this, Ali radiallahu anhu let him go. So he was so shocked that when I spit on your face, you let me go. Generally, if you're fighting with someone and if the person would spit on your face, that is the time when you would do the worst. That person knew that now I would be killed. So let me just spit on his face. Ali radiallahu anhu let him go. When he was asked why did he do this, he said, because now I got angry. And I realized if I did kill him now, it would be for my anger, not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We treat people according to who we are. That's our akhlaq. This is what we have been told. Ihsan, you be kind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. Even when you talk to people in a way that is good. And one of the things Mufassireen, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, and other Mufassireen have mentioned as bad of قُولُ النَّاسِ حُسْنًا is that in every gathering we should say something that would be part of our deen to remind people about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In every gathering there has to be some dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As there is a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if a person would sit in any gathering and would not mention Allah's name in that gathering on the day of Qiyamah, this gathering will be against that person. Allah could punish him for being in that gathering as he did not mention Allah's name or did not send blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that gathering. So part of this qulu linnasi husna, part of good word is that in every gathering there has to be some mention of our deen, of the remembrance of Allah, of the dhikr of Allah. And if there are people that are not towards deen, they are not Muslims, maybe invite them to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At least bring the name of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the gathering somehow. وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. Then وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Number 7, the 7th order is وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish salah. Then number 8, وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ, and pay the zakah. ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Bani Israel, then most of you turned away. تَوَلَّيْتُمْ, you turned away. إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ, with the exception of very few out of you. This illa qalilam minkum, if you look at it in Quran, it could mean two things. One is, most of you turned away, very few that followed these orders. Number two, the second meaning of tawallaytum illa qalilam minkum is that you turned away from most of the order, did not follow except few orders of the Book of Allah. You rejected most of the orders of Allah. You just followed very few of those books and orders of Allah. ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ As I already explained, وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ And you still are turning away from these orders. Then in the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned three more orders that were given to Bani Israel. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَكُمْ And remember, when we took a pledge from you, لَا تَسْفِكُونَ دِمَاءَكُمْ That you shall not shed the blood of each other. وَلَا تُخْرِجُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ And you would not drive each other out of your homes. ثُمَّ أَقْرَرْتُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَشْهَدُونَ Then you agreed to this, and you yourself were witnesses on it. ثُمَّ أَنْتُمْ هَؤُلَاء Then you are the very same people. تَقْتُلُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ You kill each other. وَتُخْرِجُونَ فَرِيقًا مِّنْكُمْ مِّنْ دِيَارِهِمْ And you drive your own people out of their own homes. تَظَاهَرُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِالْإِسْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ You help others, support others against them in sin and aggression. وَإِنْ يَأْتُوكُمْ أُسَارَى تُفَادُوهُمْ If they come to you as prisoners, تُفَادُوهُمْ You pay the ransom to free them. وَهُوَ مُحَرَّمٌ عَلَيْكُمْ إِخْرَاجُهُمْ Whereas taking them out of their homes was forbidden on you. فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا So what could be the punishment of those amongst you who do anything like this except disgrace in this life? وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ And on the day of judgment, they shall be returned to the most severe punishment. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ Allah is not unaware of what you do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah mentioned three more orders that were given to Bani Israel. And they did not follow those orders. Of course, these ayahs have a lot of details. Inshallah, we will go into the details of these ayahs in our next session. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. مولاي صلِّ وسلِّم دائما